Hey, PC World fans, Adam here with Gordon. And Gordon, you know the full picture on Ryzen 7000 between you reviewing it, our sister site reviewing it, all the other reviews on the internet, all sorts of goodness. But we just found out the information about Intel's 13th gen. What is the TLDR?
Well, basically it comes down to higher clock speeds, faster P cores, as you know and love, E core, P core, in like we saw in Alder Lake, 13th gen continues that, okay. But P cores faster.
Up to 5.8 gigahertz up to 5 faster. Gigahertz,
yes. Also, more E cores. Intel basically went to Oprah, said we need more E core. She said, you get an E core, you get an E core, everybody got E cores. So there's just a ton more E cores going around. Double.
Four E cores to be exact on every range, right?
Yeah.
And then.
At the top, and you get eight E cores for the Core i9.
Okay.
Yeah. Eight more. And also larger cache, larger L2 cache. So you're getting 2 megs per P core and 4 megs per E core cluster.
Interesting. Okay, and as a part of this, there's three parts that they're announcing today. What are those parts and how do those look?
Number one, let's go in reverse order because this is a biggie, very, very exciting. Core i9-13900K, 24 cores, so basically 8 P cores plus, my God, what is that, 16 E cores?
I'm not good at math, but I'm going to trust you on that one.
Up to 5.8 gigahertz on this part.
Okay.
Also 600 megahertz higher turbo boost in the middle. And is that Jan Brady? The Jan Brady. Intel Core i7-13700K, 16 cores now. Basically 4 more E cores, up to 5.4 gigahertz and 400 megahertz turbo.
Wow, okay. And on the low end?
On the low end is actually the one that I'm actually very excited about because personally I thought the Core i5-12600K basically destroyed Ryzen 5000 at the time, Ryzen 5 that is. And you're basically getting the Core i5-13600K, 14 cores. So previously you got 10 cores, you're now getting 14 cores in the i5 up to 5.1 gigahertz, 200 megahertz turbo over the older version.
Okay.
So, a lot of cores.
Yeah, a lot of cores to go around, a lot of megahertz to go around. Did they talk about performance?
Yeah, so, you know, again, you always have to take all vendor claims with a grain of salt, but let's be honest, these things are combed over by lawyers. Lawyers don't let you have any fun, make stuff up, unfortunately. There's some very bold claims. Definitely an uplift in gaming. Leadership, they're basically 6%. Some games are showing, look, Marvel Spider-Man up to 58%. Riftbreaker, I mean, there's just a lot of really high frame rates. They're basically saying up to 24% better gaming performance.
At 1080p.
At 1080p, of course. Also, I will note, this is versus existing Ryzen 9 5950X, as well as their own Core i9-12900K. Apparently, AMD was rude and did not send them a sample of the Ryzen 7000 before they put it on sale.
So, and we already know the testing of the Ryzen 7950X. Go watch that video. It's a great one. In the same time, give it a thumbs up. Smash the bell icon, subscribe, all that fun stuff for more videos. But, you know, we can kind of extrapolate a little bit. So right now they're saying it's 24% better, but if you kind of take that in there, obviously it's going to shrink down a little bit.
Yeah.
With the Ryzen 7000, right?
You know, I think with Ryzen 7000, it's going to get a little closer. And then also remember the same problem with AMD. They'll say, hey, here's 40 games. We average it out. We're this much faster. Intel's doing, hey, here's 40 games. We average it out. We're this much faster. Well, if you looked at both of them, you're not going to always find the same games in there. There's 50,000 games and apps in the Steam library, not counting Epic, not counting EA. There's just so many different stores and different games. It's a little hard to make the game performance, really. But generally, if you're going to push the clocks that hard, more cache, the core is probably not as much, but just pushing the clock speeds higher. Remember, they're saying up to 5.8 and even 6 gigahertz, but not in the parts you're seeing today. That generally is going to get you more gaming performance.
Yeah, probably, for sure. Okay, well then what about content creation though? Because that's what I'm a little bit more excited about.
Yeah, same thing there. You know, the The core counts may help a little bit more because different depends on what you're doing in the creator workflow, whatever you're doing, multitasking, what are applications you're running. The signed off lawyer claim by Intel today is up to 34% faster.
Okay, all right. Well, which things did they test in for content creation?
Well, for example, Puget Bench Photoshop overall, they're saying 33% versus a Ryzen 9 5950X. Again, Intel did not get the new Ryzen 9 7950X because AMD is being rude.
How rude? How rude?
Just rude, not sending one over. So, but they're saying 33% against Ryzen 5000, 16% in Premiere Pro, in Adobe Premiere Pro using Puget Bench, After Effects, Puget Bench, 34%. Again, very, very decent. This is one I don't really use. I haven't used it. It's AutoCAD Catalyst. Total Index, 47%. Okay, well, obviously, that's a pretty good number. I don't think you're going to see that everywhere. And Autodesk Revit Model Creation, 69%. You basically take all that up, you add it up, use special math they use in all marketing departments. I guess that somehow equals 34%.
Huh. Okay, well, I guess these look like competitive numbers. What about pricing? Is it competitively priced?
We don't know.
Oh.
I mean, that is one problem is, so as of when we're recording this today, we do not have the price. Hopefully we will have it soon.
So hold up, Gordon, from a couple days ago. We actually do have prices in. Hot off the presses, here we go with the prices. The 13900K comes in at $584, which is no increase over the 12900K. The 13700K comes in at $409, which is no increase over the 12700K. And the 13600K comes in at $320, which is $30 over the 12600K. So no increase in prices on the Core i9 and Core i7 parts, but a small increase on the Core i5 part. That's kind of interesting because Gordon and I were talking earlier that Intel was signaling that they were going to have to increase prices, and they actually didn't on the top-end parts. They did increase on the mid-range at that $300 level, so that is a bummer, but once again, we'll have to wait for testing to see just how big of a gain it is in that lower-end segment, and maybe it's justified over the $300 7600X. Either way, not bad on pricing. I expected, personally, an increase across the board, so this actually isn't too bad. Now, back to you, past Adam and Gordon. Also quite interesting that I saw in there is that Intel is kind of taking a page out of the eco mode playbook that we saw with Ryzen 7000, and they're gonna kind of do that same thing. What are their claims around eco modes?
Well, to be fair, these two teams have not met. 13th-Gen has not met Ryzen 7000 yet, so you can't say they stole from their playbook yet,
not
Internet.
True.
Just saying. Everybody's pushing, in efficiency. One thing they're saying with 13900K, though, this is the bold claim. We'll have to see when we get it. So they're saying a 12900K with a baseline of 241 watts of boost, that's PL1. The 13900K will do that at 65 watts. So they're basically saying, it does sound an awful lot like what we've seen with AMD this week, honestly.
Right?
Because
Yeah. Remember,
Ryzen 7950X, faster than 5950X at 65 watts, which is kind of mind-blowing. Intel is saying, hey, our 13900K, same performance as a 12900K with a PL1 of 241 watts. If you push it to 115 watts, you get 21% more multi-threaded performance. If you push it up to 241 watts, it's 37% faster than a 12900K, which is, again, it's no slouch in multi-threaded, although definitely gets beat up pretty badly by Ryzen 7000 that I'm seeing. And if you push it to 253 watts, you're looking at a plus 41%.
Which, I should stop right there. That's signaling that these parts, at the if you push it to the maximum, they're saying it's gonna go up to 253 watts. Because of it. Right now, the 12900K, 241 watts-ish,
yeah.
You know?
So the
TDP,
PL1s.
So yeah, you're saying the TDP is going to be raised over to 12th-gen.
It will definitely push it a little harder than the previous generation. But again, they're saying, hey, it's cool. at 65 watts, the microarchitecture and the chip itself will actually perform the same. That's not saying the same as AMD's EcoBoost, but I suppose you could tune a 13900K down to 65 watts. It's not clear to me that they're going to say you should do that for this instead of buying a 65-watt CPU.
Either way, I'm excited to live in this world of interesting ways that you can configure your CPU based off of what power you want to target. So, also, it looks like there's a couple software improvements for it. What are they?
Yeah, so Intel has what they're calling Intel Thread Director 2. Basically, I will read you the
sequel.
The sequel. Yes, sequels are sometimes better. Updated. I'm just trying to think. Godfather 2 better than Godfather 1? Not sure. Updated thread class boundaries by machine learning techniques. Basically, it's going to get, you know, smarter, better. Original Thread Director basically managed where all the threads from software and the OS should go. It sounds like they're from their learnings, as they like to say, it's even better. This next point, though, can be a little controversial. Windows 11 22H2, which is the new version of Windows 11, it's just starting to roll out now. Optimized handling of background services, utility quality of service versus user-initiated background tasks, low quality of service. Basically, it sounds like with Windows 11, 22H2, so the latest version of Windows 11, which is free to everybody who can get 11, the new 13th-Gen should actually manage those background processes better. So a lot of this, or at least some of this performance, might actually be tied to Windows 11, which is, of course, going to set some people off because they don't like right mouse clicking and then right mouse clicking some more to get to what they want to get to. Microsoft.
I'm still on Windows 10, so I guess I'll see what I get.
And also dynamic tuning technology coming to the mobile versions of these chips. That is actually the one big black hole in my map here. Well, we have information on the desktop parts, which, frankly, everybody on YouTube gets super jazzed and angry about all the time. We don't know much what's happening with the 13th-gen mobile parts, so those are definitely coming.
Okay, all right. Well, at the end of the day, with everything that you've seen from Intel, obviously we'll need to wait for final testing. But then all the testing that you've done from Ryzen 7000 and all the testing everyone else has done, should you wait to upgrade and buy into 13th gen? Or do you think it's fine? Just go ahead and buy Ryzen 7000, all sorts of goodness. We've seen how good it is. Just go ahead and buy Ryzen 7000.
Well, I'm gonna recommend, because you have to think about this, because we have in hand Ryzen 7000 benchmarks.
Yeah, good
you
stuff.
See it, go
good
to the
stuff.
Web video. It's awesome. It's an impressive chip. It's definitely the top tier performance CPU for desktop users.
Right now,
seeing what I'm seeing from Intel, basically saying 15% better single-threaded performance, 41% better multi-thread performance, that's in spec. But I would guess, yeah, I would wait. If it were me, and you know, the thing that's interesting now for AMD is because they don't have the old, you already got your AM4 socket. So you don't have to replace everything. Going from AM4 to AM5 means if you are an existing AMD customer, you got to move. So you have to sort of break. That is kind of gone. I would wait, because honestly, you could be doing a clean build if you're coming from an older Intel socket or if you're coming from an older AMD socket. If you got a 12th gen, yeah, you're probably not going to upgrade anyway. But you're really looking at a new build and you're looking at 15% single threaded. If that holds up, I'm going to say Intel's going to outperform AMD in lightly threaded tasks. In multi-threaded tasks, I think it's going to be basically dead even again when we get to 13th gen because, you know, hey, this is a big level of 41% over 12th gen, but Ryzen 7000 is about 40% faster than 12th gen too. So it might be kind of dead even on multi-threaded tasks, but lightly threaded is very, very important.
Yeah, but AM5, the AMD says it's going to support it through at least 2025. Any mention in being able to drop a 14th gen in the same socket?
We have no news, zero news. But it is interesting. I will point out that it was said, it's been reported out of the press tour they did in Israel. Intel said, you know what, we weren't going to make 13th gen, but we were afraid the brand new stuff, the tiled architecture, really, really advanced Meteor Lake that's coming next year, 14th gen, we have to have a hedge against that. If it doesn't work out, and actually since they've said it's working out, we're coming back, we're gonna be giving everybody a hard time with 14th gen, but they said we weren't gonna make 13th gen. But so they're here with it anyway. It kind of made me think like, huh, if they said they weren't gonna make 13th gen, would that have meant Alder Lake would have been the only CPU in that socket? And that's been pretty rare for Intel. In fact, I can't think that would be the exception to the rule. So it almost makes you think, again, Intel has never said that 14th Gen will drop into current motherboards. But if 13th Gen wasn't going to happen, does that mean Meteor Lake would have gone into 12th Gen in socket? The current 12th Gen socket? Because it makes you wonder.
I don't know.
But you do know that Intel never says, because the lawyers are no fun about this stuff, because you got to guarantee if it's going to happen. AMD has said, we're going to do it. You buy AM5. We're going to see you at least, two, three generations probably? 2 or 3 years anyway.
Yeah, okay, interesting. Okay, all right, well, I guess it sounds like we should wait. Sounds like it's worth
wait.
It to
I
wait
mean,
just to
like
see full performance and pricing, unless, you just want to go Team Red.
Yeah, that's fair. You can do that. I just think that generally if you want to make a decision, it's always better to wait to be fully informed. And the fact that they're talking about it means it's not that far away. So you're probably going to see benchmarks on it sooner rather than later. So we're not talking waiting into next year. It's going to be soon.
Okay.
Can you just wait a little bit? That's what I told my daughter. It's like, you know what? You waited all this time. You don't want to buy the iPhone 13 right before the iPhone 14 comes out. And she waited and waited and did it. So she almost couldn't do it. We did it, though.
Okay. Good for her. She got an iPhone.
Yeah,
okay. Yeah. Good. Great. thank you, everybody, for watching this. I guess we'll know more soon. Hopefully, be sure to subscribe because Gordon will be testing that. We will be doing a lot of coverage around that for sure. Thank you, Gordon, for walking through this with me. If you have any questions about whether you should upgrade or not, put them down in the comments. We'll be in there and try to help you figure it out. So thanks, everyone. See you later. Thank you.